Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alhamdulillah, I'm very excited to have you here with us.
Alhamdulillah, it's a pleasure for me to be with you.
I keep thinking back, we spent a little time together, me, you and Yusuf Estes, and we spent hours together, and I know you're very enthusiastic about giving da'wah because you've come so far. Allah has blessed you. And I was so tired and I didn't even get a chance to ask you for us to do something. And I made dua, I said, Allah, please make it happen. And we're here together today on the Deen Show.
Allah accept it, inshallah.
Ameen, yes. So we're going to get straight to the topic. There's some confusion out there. People are worshipping the sun. They're worshipping the moon. They're worshipping a man. So in this particular show, because you're an expert on this topic, we want to give the top reasons why the creator of the heavens and the earth, God Almighty, in Arabic we say Allah, is not a man, never was a man, never tried to be a man.
If we analyze all the major religions of the world, except for Islam, all the other major religions of the world, they believe that Almighty God became a human being once or more number of times.
Yes.
All the major religions except Islam, they believe that Almighty God either once or many times became a human being. And they believe in a philosophy known as anthropomorphism.
Uh-huh.
Anthropomorphism means that Almighty God taking forms and he becomes a human being. And when we ask them that why does Almighty God have to become a human being? So they say that Almighty God, he's so holy, he's so pure, he's so noble. He does not know the shortcomings of the human beings.
Uh-huh.
He does not know how does he make me feel when he's hurt, when he's angry, when he requires certain things. He doesn't know the requirements of the human being, how do they feel, etc. That's the reason Almighty God came into this world and became a human being to know what is good or what is bad for the human being.
Mm-hmm.
On the face of it, it sounds to be a very good logic.
Yeah.
Almighty God, so holy, so pure, so noble, does not know the shortcomings of the human being, does not know how a human being feels when he's hurt, when he's in problems. So, it sounds to be good.
Yeah.
But I tell them that suppose I happen to manufacture a DVD player.
Yeah.
I create a DVD player. Now because I'm a manufacturer of a DVD player, do I have to become a DVD player to know what is good or what is bad for the DVD player?
Obviously.
Because I'm the manufacturer,
yeah.
I'm the creator, I don't have to become a DVD player. What do? I write an instruction manual.
Exactly.
That if you want to play the DVD, insert the DVD and press the play button.
Yes.
If you want to skip, press the skip button. If you want to stop, press the stop button. I don't have to become a DVD player to know what is good or what is bad for the DVD player. Because I'm the creator. Similarly, Almighty God, he is the creator of the human being. So he does not have to become a human being to know what is good or what is bad for the human being. What does he do? He chooses a man amongst men. And he communicates with them on a higher level, who we call as messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't have to come himself. And the last and final message, the last and final instruction manual for the human beings is the glorious Quran. So that is the reason what they give foremost,
mm-hmm.
that Almighty God became a human being based on anthropomorphism philosophy,
yeah.
can be argued that it's not required for the creator to become the creation.
Yeah. Now we have a lot of non-Muslims watching this show, and you said an Arabic word. You said Allah. Can you tell us what this means?
Allah, by definition,
yes,
is the best definition I can give you. It's quoted in Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1-4, which says,
"Qul huwa Allahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad." وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ
قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ Says Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah, the absolute and eternal. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُلَدْ He begets not, nor is he begotten. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ There's nothing like him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Almighty God. Any person says that so-and-so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting him as Almighty God. The first is, say he's Allah one and only. Second is, Allahu Samad, Allah the absolute and eternal. Third is, Lam yulid wa lam yulad, he begets not nor is he begotten. And the fourth is, Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there is nothing like him. And this Surah Ikhlas, according to me, is the touchstone of theology. Theo means God, logy means study. Theology, study of God, it is the touchstone of theology. Any human being who who wants to identify or verify whether the God he or she is worshipping is true or not, let him or her put that God to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If he passes the test, he is a true God, otherwise he is a fake God.
Now tell us, now it's known commonly that people take one that is beloved to our hearts. We love him as one of the mightiest messengers of God. But many are claiming that he said he was God, that he's the Son of God. There's some confusion here. What do we have to say about this?
Yes, I do agree that most of the Christians, they believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he claimed divinity. Many of the Christians believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was God.
Yes.
But if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement, not a single unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me.
Anywhere in the Bible.
If any Christian can point out a single unequivocal statement, a single unambiguous statement where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity. In fact, if you read the Bible, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14. Verse number 28. Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29. My Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28. I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20. I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 20. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, the will of Almighty God. It's mentioned in Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 30, that not my will, but God's will. Anyone who says it's not my will but God's will is a Muslim. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was a Muslim. And there are several quotations I can give you where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, never claimed divinity. He never said he was God, but he was a messenger of God. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse 24. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that the words that you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3 says, this is life eternal, so that you may know one true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. And it's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. It says that, ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by men, you witnessed to it. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him. And when he was asked which is the first of the commandment, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12, verse 29. He said the same thing what Moses has said earlier. Shema Israelo, adnahinu adnaychad. It's the Hebrew quotation which means, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord.
Now, you being an expert in this area, in this field, did Moses, Noah, Abraham, the first man, Adam, did they ever worship a man God, a son of God? Is there anything, any reference to this?
None of the prophets of God. None of the prophets mentioned in the Bible, right from Adam, peace be upon him, to Jesus, peace be upon him.
Never.
Never. It is a misconception amongst the Christians, which the church proclaims, that Jesus claimed divinity. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the Bible where Jesus ever said, peace be upon him, that worship me, or that he's God.
Now, you said something that's clear, lucid. The verses that you gave are easy to understand, but someone says, you know what? I think that I heard something from my preacher. He said, I and the Father are one. No one comes to the Father but me. How do we take this and explain what this means?
As far as the first statement you said, I and my Father are one, it's a quotation of Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 30.
Yes.
I and my Father are one. But you have to go to the context. If you go to the context in Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse 23, you come to know, it says that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and entered the temple in Solomon's porch. Verse number 24 says that all the Jews surrounded him. All the Jews, they surrounded him, and they asked him that, if thou art the Christ, please tell us plainly. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, replies in verse number 25, that I told you, but you believe not. Verse number 26, you do not believe me because you are not my sheep. Verse number 27, my people who follow me, they are my sheep, they listen to me. Verse number 28, no man can pluck them out of my hand. I give them eternal life, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Verse number 29, my Father who give it to me is greater than all. No man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. So if you see the context in verse number 28, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that my followers, no one can pluck them out of my hand. No one can pluck them out of my Father's hand, verse number 29. Verse number 30 says, I and my Father are one. So in context, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Almighty God, they are one in purpose, but not one as one entity. Mm-hmm. In context, my father is a doctor, I am a doctor, and if I say I and my father are one, it means one in profession. It does not mean as we are joined as one human being.
That makes sense, yes.
But then it insists, no, Dr. Zakir, you have misunderstood the verse of the Bible, it means one only. I said, fine, I always believe in dialogue. I agree with the wrong argument and then disprove you. If I agree with you that this one means one in person, if you go ahead in Gospel of John chapter number 17, verse number 21, it says that Jesus Christ says, my Father is in me, I in thee, talking to the 12 disciples. Mm-hmm. We all are one. The same one is used here. Same word. So do you mean to say God and Jesus and the 12 disciples are 14 gods? So now I have to coin a new word. Instead of Trinity, you have to coin a new word saying 14 in one. And again further if you go, in Gospel of John chapter 17 verse 23, Jesus Christ peace be upon says, I in thee and you in me. To 12 disciples and Jesus Christ peace be upon, they are one, that means 13 gods. So now I have to coin a new word for 13 gods. So the right thing is one in purpose.
Now, another one that I mentioned that is very popular.
That I am the way, the truth and the life, no man comes to Father but by me.
Exactly.
So you quoted the last part, that no man comes to Father but by me, but the full quotation is from Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 6, which says that I am the way, the truth and the life. No man cometh unto my Father but through me. This again, point number one, it's not an unequivocal statement saying that Jesus is God, peace be upon him. But if you read the context, you come to know what does it mean. Context, go to Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse number 1. It says that, why are you troubled? If you believe in God, believe in me also. Verse number 2 says, in my Father's mansion there are many houses. I am going there to prepare a place for you. If it was not so, I wouldn't have told you. The verse continues and it says that I am going to prepare a place for you. Now you know where I go. So one disciple asked him that, Master, we don't know where you go. Then he said, I am the way, the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but through me. In context, it means that if you have to reach God, you have to follow the pathway of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Every messenger, at his time, he was the way, the truth and the life. No man came unto Almighty God but through the messenger. At the time of Moses, Moses was the way, the truth and the life. No man came unto Almighty God but through Moses. At the time of Jesus, most verily, because he was the messenger of God, at his time, he was the way, the truth and the life. No man came unto Almighty God but through Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Today, the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the way and the truth and the life. No man can reach Almighty God except through the pathway of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But that does not make Prophet Muhammad as God.
Not at all. Yeah.
As Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. He shall glorify me. This is talking about Prophet Muhammad to come. So it means, this verse means that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was the messenger of Almighty God.
Couple more points. So much to cover, so little time. Tell us. Some people say, well, God is almighty. He knows all. He has power over all things. He can do anything. What does this mean? So they say that God can do anything. So why can't he become a man? What do you say about this?
That's a common argument that's put forth, that why are you restricting the powers of God?
Exactly.
God can do anything, everything. So why are you restricting the powers of Almighty God? And I tell them, for sake of argument, I agree with you, God can do anything and everything. And you say that God can become a human being. So if I agree with you, God can become a human being, then you have to realize once God becomes a human being, he ceases to be God. You say God can become a human, I have no problem, but he ceases to be God. You cannot say there's a God-man. If you say there's a God-man, God who has become man and has the power of God, it doesn't make sense. Why? Because by definition, God is immortal. Human being is mortal. You can either have an immortal person or a mortal person. You can have a person who is immortal and mortal at the same time. It is meaningless.
Doesn't make sense.
Doesn't make sense. Almighty God has no beginning. Human beings have a beginning. Mm-hmm. You can't have a person who has no beginning and has a beginning at the same time. It's meaningless. Almighty God has got no end. Human beings have an end. You can't have a person who has no end and has an end at the same time. It's meaningless. It's like telling I saw a tall, short man. You either have a tall man or a short man. It is absolutely, you cannot use a word like in tall, short.
Yeah.
You either have a tall man, short man, or a medium man. Mm-hmm. You can't have a tall, short man. You can't have a fat, thin man. Similarly, you can't have a God man.
Yes.
For example, Almighty God does not require to eat. Mm-hmm. Human means required to eat.
Yes.
Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 14, it is Allah who feeds everyone but does not require to be fed. We human beings, we require rest and sleep. Almighty God does not require rest and sleep. Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 255, in Ayatul Kursi, Allahu la ilaha al-hayyul qayyum, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm, lahu ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard. It's Allah, He is the one, the eternal, self-sustaining. No slumber can see them, nor does He require rest. To Him belongs everything in the heaven and the earth. So if I carry forward the argument that God can do anything and everything, if I agree, then even God can tell a lie. But to tell a lie is ungodly. The moment God tells a lie, He ceases to be God. So similarly, if you say that Almighty God became a human being, if I agree, fine, but He loses the power of God. If He loses the power of God, what is the use of worshipping that human being, like you and me?
Yeah.
And then they say that human being became God. If a human being can become God, tomorrow you and I also can be God. And my next question is, if God became human being, who controlled the world for more than 30 years?
Yeah.
If I agree with the Christian, God became human being, who controlled the world for those 30 days? So they keep on going in circles here and there, you know, like that, happening there. And furthermore, if I agree with the argument of God can do anything and everything, God can also do injustice. But to do injustice is ungodly. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 440, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. The moment God does injustice, He ceases to be God. If I agree with the argument God can do anything and everything, God can even forget. But to forget is ungodly. Allah says in Surah Taha chapter 20 verse 52 that Allah never forgets. The moment God forgets, He ceases to be God. In that same argument, God can even make a mistake. Or to make mistake is ungodly. Quran says in Surah Taha chapter 20 verse 52, Allah never makes a mistake. The moment God makes a mistake, He ceases to be God. So nowhere does the Quran say that God can do anything and everything. What does the Quran say? Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. For verily, Allah has power over all things. In Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 106, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 109, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 284, in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 29, in Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 77, in Surah Fatir chapter 35 verse number 1, in several places the Quran says, Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. For verily, Allah has power over all things. That is the reason Allah says in Surah Buraj chapter 85 verse 16, Allah is the doer of all intents. Whatever Allah intends, He can do. But God will never intend doing ungodly things like telling a lie, like making a mistake, like becoming a human being. So what God intends, He can do. Mm-hmm. But to say God can do anything and everything, it is illogical.
We want to close and wrap it up with this. Tell us, there are thousands upon thousands watching us, and there are many sincere people out there, our brothers in humanity, that are listening and they hear this clear message that you're explaining to them. It makes sense. It's rational. It's not something where you have to do a lot of mental gymnastics to make fit. And you know what? They want to get to paradise. They want to do what the Creator wants them to do. Give them some advice on how they can come over and do and live that life of all the messengers of God, worshiping God alone, and at the end, being in paradise and being our brothers in faith. Can you give them some advice?
The advice that I give to the non-Muslim brothers is that agree at least one scripture is the word of God. So Christian would not mind saying that, okay, what the Bible says is the word of God. The Hindu would not mind saying that Veda is the word of God. The Muslim would not mind saying that the Quran is the word of God. So I tell them, what is common in all these scriptures, let us agree to follow that. What is difference, what is differing, we can discuss tomorrow. Let us agree to follow 100% what is common in all these scriptures. And when you do research, you come to know, all the scriptures say there is one God. All the quotations I gave from the Bible,
yes.
I can give from the Vedas, same in the Quran. All the scriptures say that God has got no images. He has got no idols. God does not beget. He has got no children. He has got no father. All the scriptures say that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Bible says in several places, in the book of Deuteronomy chapter number 18, verse number 18, in the book of Deuteronomy chapter number 18, verse number 19, in the book of Isaiah chapter 29, verse number 12, in the Song of Solomon chapter 5, verse number 16, in the Gospel of John chapter 14, verse 16, in the Gospel of John chapter 15, verse 26, in the Gospel of John chapter 16, verse number 7, in the Gospel of John chapter 16, verse number 11 to 14. I can go on and on and on, only quoting references. You can give a talk for hours together, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Bible. You can give a talk for us together, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Hindu scriptures. So, when it is clearly mentioned, in all the scriptures, God is one who has got no images, who has got no idols. He is not a human being. He has got no father. He has got no son. All the scriptures say, the last and final messenger to come is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only in the Christian scriptures or the Hindu scriptures, in the Parsi scriptures, in the Buddhist scriptures, all these scriptures. So I request all the brothers from throughout the world, read your scriptures. At least agree to follow what is common. And then you'll come to know, and you'll have to believe, if you're sincere, that there is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the Messenger of Almighty.
Now, people love what you have to say. We have to come to an end. There's the top TV program in the world, the Islamic program that everyone can come to, non-Muslims and Muslims. They want to hear more of you and more of what you have to say. Can you please tell us really quickly, we only got a few more seconds, about this Peace TV?
The Peace TV was launched more than 3 years back. And now, mashallah, it's available on 6 satellites. It's available throughout the world. In North America and South America, it's available on Galaxy 18.
Galaxy 18.
Galaxy 18.
Anyone who has a dish?
Anyone has a dish, they have to turn the dish to 123.5 degrees west. It's on the 18 number transponder, and the frequency is 11966. So if you have a dish, you just turn it to 123.5 degrees west, and the frequency is 11966. Or if you want to maintain the old channel, it hardly cost about $200 to put a new dish. It's a free-to-air channel. You can watch it 24 hours. And inshallah, you will really appreciate it. It's free-to-air.
Thank you very much.
It's a
pleasure. May God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and earth, Allah reward you for
inshallah,
being with us.
Inshallah. Amin.
And thank you for tuning in to another episode of The Deen Show. If you like what we had to say, tune in every week. We're here trying to humbly help you understand Islam. And if you'd like to learn more, or if you like to become our brothers, sisters in faith, call the number on the screen, 1-800-662-ISLAM. Until next time, assalamu alaikum, peace be unto you.